In order to understand the motion of fluids on our Earth, we need to understand the effect of the Earth's rotation. The Navier-Stokes equations that we have derived before are valid in an inertial reference frame. They describe how the fluid's velocity field reacts to forces, in particular to gravity, the pressure gradient force, and internal viscous stresses. However, it would be more practical if we could describe fluid flow in a reference frame that is attached to the rotating Earth. Hence, we must find out what the Navier-Stokes equations look like in such an Earth-fixed coordinate system. Before we start, there are a number of things I would like to draw your attention to. First, gravity is such a large and omnipresent force that for all practical situations it ensures that things remain attached to the Earth. Second, in the following we will encounter some terms that depend on the position of a particle on Earth, mostly its latitude. But some other terms depend on the velocity of the particle. Finally, although we describe motion on a sphere, all of the equations that we will derive here will be written in terms of local Cartesian coordinates, so we will not encounter complexities related to spherical coordinates. Let us start with making the connection between the description of a particle in an inertial reference frame and an arbitrary reference frame. The position of the orange dot is denoted by the position vector r in the inertial frame. Then we define a new reference frame denoted by x prime, y prime, and z prime. The position of this new reference frame is given by the position vector capital R. Then the position of the orange dot in the new coordinate system is given by vector r prime. Next, we want to describe the velocity of the dot. This implies that we take the time derivative of the position vector r. On the right-hand side, this gives the sum of the velocity vector of the new reference frame and the velocity vector of the point relative to the origin of the new reference frame. Recall that a vector is the product of the components in the given reference frame and the unit vectors of that reference frame. Hence, the change of the position of the dot in the new reference frame depends both on its velocity in the new reference frame, that's the first term, and on the rate of change of the unit vectors, the second term. Let's have a closer look at that change of the unit vectors. When we look at a coordinate system that is fixed to a rotating Earth, we see that it is both translated and rotated. But for the unit vectors in the coordinate system, the variation of the origin of the coordinate system is not relevant. Only the change of the orientation of the unit vectors counts. Now let us consider this rotation of the unit vectors in more detail. First, we consider a situation where the unit vector is perpendicular to the rotation vector. After some time delta t, the unit vector has changed to a new direction. It has turned over an angle delta theta. The difference vector between the new and the old unit vector is to a good approximation equal to delta theta. For this, you have to remember that unit vectors have length 1, so the difference vector lies on the unit circle. Now we know the magnitude of the difference vector. But how about its direction? Well, its direction is both perpendicular to the rotation vector and to the original unit vector. So this direction can be obtained by taking the cross product between the two. By the way, note that in the drawing, the difference vector is not exactly perpendicular to the unit vector because we let the unit vector turn over quite a large angle. Anyway, in order to have a vector of length 1 to describe the direction of the difference vector, we still have to divide again by the length of the cross product of omega and the unit vector. Also, note that the rotation angle delta theta is in fact the result of applying a rotation rate omega over a given amount of time delta t. Now this expression can be further simplified. And then moving the delta t to the left hand side, we finally obtain an expression for the rate of change of the unit vector. Well, next we do the same exercise for a situation where the rotation vector and the unit vector are not perpendicular. The angle between the rotation vector and the unit vector is now alpha. Again, we let the rotation do its work over a time delta t. This leads to a new orientation of the unit vector. The difference between the old and the new orientation is given by the difference vector delta e. The magnitude of this difference vector now has a term sine of alpha. Because the projection of the unit vector on the plane perpendicular to the rotation vector has length sine of alpha. As we have seen before, the difference vector is both perpendicular to the unit vector and the rotation vector, hence the cross product of both. From this we can again obtain an expression for the rate of change of the unit vector. From the definition of the cross product of two vectors, we know that it is equal to the product of the length of both times the sine of the angle between both vectors. This brings us to our final result. So, irrespective of the angle between the rotation vector and the unit vector, the rate of change of the unit vector is equal to the cross product of the rotation vector and the unit vector. The fact that the cross product is involved makes sense. The change in the unit vector is maximum when the rotation vector is perpendicular to the unit vector. On the other hand, when both are parallel, for instance, a vertical unit vector on the North Pole, the rotation does not have an effect on the direction of the unit vector at all. After this intermezzo, it's time to go back to further understand the relation between motion in an inertial reference system and a rotating reference frame. Since the Navier-Stokes equations are all about accelerations, we need to find out how accelerations are related between both reference frames. Since we know already how the velocities are related, we only need to take the time derivatives of both. The position vector r is the product of the magnitude of the component and the corresponding unit vector. So we can apply the product rule of differentiation to split the term. The red term depends on the velocity in the new reference frame. The second term depends on the rotation of the unit vectors of the new reference frame. The term on the left-hand side is the material acceleration in the inertial reference frame. That is exactly the acceleration for which the Navier-Stokes equations would be valid. Next, we expand the time derivative on the right-hand side, using the product rule. This yields a total of 5 terms. The first term we will address later. The second term is the acceleration of the particle as it is described in the new reference frame. The third and the fourth terms are related to motion in the new reference frame. As the particle moves, its direction seems to change. Finally, the last term is related to the location of a particle in the new reference frame. Now let's interpret the various terms. The term on the left-hand side is simply the acceleration in the inertial reference frame. The first term on the right-hand side is the acceleration of the origin of the moving reference frame. We will discuss this later. The second term on the right-hand side is the acceleration of the particle in the moving reference frame. This is the acceleration that we observe when we, as observers, are attached to the Earth. The third and the fourth term are identical. We take them together. They can be rewritten based on what we've learned about how unit vectors change when their reference frame is rotating. Finally, the last term shows how the unit vectors are accelerating when rotating. Now let us look at the physical interpretation of all of these terms. The first term on the right-hand side denotes how the origin of our rotating coordinate system is accelerating. We should realize that the speed of the coordinate system is immense. The speed with which we move through space is quite high. But the acceleration is very small. First, the angular speed around the Sun is quite constant. And although the path is curved, this curvature is so small that the first term is very small compared to the others. Now we skip to the last term. This last term denotes the centripetal acceleration that is needed to keep the particle attached to the Earth. It is gravity that provides this acceleration. Now we move this term to the other side in the momentum equation, the side where all the forces are. This implies that the term changes sign and becomes the centrifugal acceleration. This acceleration is then combined with the acceleration due to gravity, and then it becomes the net gravity. This net gravity is directed along the normal to the local Earth surface due to the deformation of the Earth. This gives us the following momentum equation, where the centripetal acceleration is now absorbed as a centrifugal force into the net gravity force. Finally, we discuss the Coriolis term. The magnitude of this acceleration depends on the magnitude of the component of the rotation vector that is normal to the direction of the motion of the particle. So, if the particle moves horizontally along the Earth's surface, It's product of omega and the sine of latitude that determines the Coriolis acceleration. The direction of the acceleration is always normal to the plane defined by the rotation vector and the velocity vector. Now, what does that mean in terms of components? Here we look, as an example, at the momentum equation for the x component, that is, for the zonal wind, east-west wind. On the right-hand side, we see that gravity is missing, as gravity has no influence on the horizontal wind. The cross product of rotation factor and velocity factor has produced two terms here, one depending on the meridional wind, that is, the north-south wind, and one depending on the vertical wind. If we focus on the situation in which the flow is mainly horizontal, the second Coriolis term becomes negligible. This simplifies the equation. Furthermore, we summarize the term 2 times omega times the sine of latitude into a single variable called f. This is the definition of the Coriolis parameter. So, to summarize, the Navier-Stokes equations are in fact only valid in an inertial reference system. So, if we want to apply them in a rotating reference system, we need to come up with a number of extra terms. These terms are related to the translation acceleration. Well, that's quite small. An important term is the centripetal term, but that we absorb in gravity, so it vanishes from the equations. And finally, the Coriolis term, which depends on the velocity component perpendicular to the rotation. And it's this term that actually appears in the equations that we usually use in a rotating reference frame. The definition of the Coriolis parameter, f, is only useful for horizontal flow.